Updated again, it's Finnabair Free here, and we are going to start our Facebook Live show. It's going to be together with Prima Marketing, and this time we're going to also show a bit of 7.0 Studio Papers, which is my company from which my heart belongs to for many years. So this is going to be a really exciting moment for myself. Okay, hello Sue, I can see friends are joining, so it's good to have support of your friends as well. And I can see some of my design team members and a lot of lovely faces that I recognize from the other shows. So let's get started. Are you ready? Okay, are we really ready? This is the plan. We are going to work on this gift bag, and you just need a very popular paper bag. That's it. Okay, so first of all, we are going to use the brown paper bag. So this is something you may get from basically anywhere. And maybe my lovely assistant Pascal is going to give me one because I forgot to take one. It's there in the boxes in the corner. But in the meantime, let's have a look at the elements. It's good to have some stamps that are going to go with the vintage mood. And this is the one that you can see at Michael's. This is the combination of the stencil and stamps, and they are all of the lovely numbers, and there will be some letters and some old adverts, you know, something that really goes nicely with the vintage combination. So anything in that style will work, and then it's good to have some permanent ink going with that. Archival or Stazon will work really nicely. Then the next thing you will need, it will be some set of vintage looking papers. I'm going to use Airmail collection. This is the very new one from 7.0 Studio. And if you look at the papers, they're absolutely delicious. And they go perfectly with the idea I had on my mind. I even have some vintage photos. So this kind of paper collection that is in vintage colors, maybe something inspired by the post office stamps, that will be great selection. Then you will need some paper flowers, for example this set that you can find at Michael's or any other nice Prima paper flowers. I suggest to use something in lighter color palette, so it will be easy to change the colors of it. And if you want to find the stamps, Karen is just giving you the links to find them. Then from the embellishments, something like rusty elements. So I'm planning to use some elements from this set. These are my mechanicals. You can find similar one at Michael's in the set, or these are just the ones that you can buy in your local stores all over the world. So something nice and rusty. And then I'm going to use mica powders. So this is the set of mica powders which is available at Michael's, but you may recognize them as the single jars of mica powders which are available in the local stores, and they will be exactly the same product, just different packaging. So I'm going to mostly use the gold, brown and silver color. Then the next set of really lovely ingredients, these are microbeads, and I would like to use the silver color. Again, this is something you can find at Michael's or in the single jars in your local craft stores. But this set and this set, if you are from Europe, it is starting to be available in the local stores now. So you just have to check out, because I can see it is possible to ship to countries outside of the US now. And for the art mediums, well, we don't really need much. You can look into the set and pick the 3D gloss gel, which is not a surprise, and white gesso. Or if you don't have a set, if you are not able to get that, you can buy them in single jars in most of the craft stores as well in Europe. Or this is what I'm doing, I use the jars, like I'm really using the big jars. So heavy white gesso, and we are going to use the 3D gloss gel as well. So these are two art mediums only in this project. So you can say this is not super heavy mixed media, but it's going to be fun, and it's going to be in this lovely vintage, a little bit shabby, a little bit like junk style, which I really, really love. So before we are going to start to build the layers here. What other elements do you need? I was trying to find nice elements that will be going with it, and then in this collection, airmail, like all the other Seven Dwarfs Studio collections, there will be some tags, so I have some of these ready. And then I have a photo, right? So this is a vintage, small vintage photo. As far as I remember, this is from Tim Holt's set of the photos, the one that goes in the little strips. Then I've got also some paper elements from the same Hermes collection. I've got some chipboards, some sayings, and some stickers. I will pick something from that, and then of course the paper bag. So try to look at the collections. For example, Prima had some lovely vintage collections designed by Frank, and these may be very good choice for making this kind of project. If not, if you may be not really having this kind of papers at home because you're not that much into scrapbooking projects or card making, you can try just using vintage paper taken from the old books or music note paper and tags that are attached to your clothes when you buy them. So these are Seven Dots papers, Seven Dots Studio, and this is the new collection, like this airmail. There's one more coming now called Garden Party, both beautiful. But you can look for similar options. This is just important to have more or less neutral vintage inspired color palette. This is the only requirement really. So let's start with the background layers. And to make this bag, I really started with some basic stamping. So this is the set of stamps I will be using. This is going to be just a little bit of the random stamping. I plan to stamp more or less that far, because later I'm going to build layers on the top anyway, so part of that will be covered. I didn't really worry that much. So I take the stamps and I take the ink, and I sometimes use the stamping block, but to be honest, not so often. So I'm just going to ink the stamps generally, all of them. Because this is just background stamping, I'm just going to stamp a kind of random way. These will be covered anyway, partly by the embellishments and also by gesso, so I can be really careless. This is more like adding the pattern to the paper in the background. So, as you can see, no much stress, really, just stamping to add the nice patterns. If there is some kind of design that you really like, for example, numbers are really cool here on the side, you can make sure they will be visible. And it is just like the first of the steps, so I'm going to add a little bit more here, maybe a little bit more there. This is probably won't be visible at all. Well, it happens. So then I will pick the one that I want to have visible. This is the one that says postcard. And I will stamp it in the place that hopefully I can see later. Perfect. And now, before I will do even more stamping on it, I'm going to put a very thin coat of gesso. And this is going to create like a lovely white film on the top. So I will take one of my silicone brushes and I will just create a film to give it like a coat that is going to be like almost like white wax. So I'm not going to be careful again, I'm just going to create nice layer of white, and then it's going to get much more transparent after drying. You can see I try to remove most of the gesso now, so it's basically very very thin. And because it's going to be old looking, you don't have to really make sure it's beautiful and even. We just leave it as it is. And then I will give it a moment of drying with the heat gun. So now we can play a little bit more. So these elements are half visible, and I'm going to add some more of them on the top to make it more multi-layered and interesting. So now you can be tiny bit more careful, but you know, perfection is overrated. Even the stamp says less perfection, more authenticity. So I'm trying to follow that idea. Just adding a bit more of the patterns. I really like the one with the hand, so I'm going to make sure the hand is visible. Very cool, I think. And then the small hand on the other side here. Of course, you can be more careful. You don't have to stamp like me. You can just use the block and make sure the elements are in the right places. But there is some charm, I think, in this kind of freestyle stamping when you don't have to worry that much about the results, when you just can enjoy the process. And this is creating this messy look that I'm going for. So just adding a tiny bit more. Oh, this is like the stamp that I really like for here. Okay, so the first step is done. Let me show you closer. We have double layered stamping. This one bottom layer of stamps, just the same archival ink, then one coat of gesso, dried, and then we put the second coat. So we have two layers of stamping. Some of them will be visible, some of them won't be visible. So just in case if I want to stamp even more on the paper, I keep my stamps and ink on the side. And now I need to start working on that part of the composition. So I would like to have really a vintage look. So either I have to find a book, a very old page from the book, or I have to find the paper that looks like the old paper from the book. For example, this one looks just perfectly like taken from the old notebook. So that is going to be the plan. I have some of the smaller pieces cut already because I'm not master of cutting straight, so I did it in advance. And I will just add the layer of this paper that is going to be the main base of the project. So I will rip it on the side, make sure it's going to be visible. Maybe tiny bit on the other side as well. That looks quite promising. And this is going to be the body of my main composition. So now I can just stick it and then add some other pieces of paper for extra dimension. And measuring is not going to help, to be honest. So it's just good to let it go and enjoy the process of gluing. I'm thinking about one more layer of paper just to make it more interesting. How about this one? Looks really nice. So it's going to piece on the side, like this. That would be really nice. Okay, so now gluing. You can just use gel medium for gluing, or you can use any kind of the favorite double-sided tape or anything else that you like. I'm going to use a 3D gloss gel because I like my life simple, and this is very sticky anyway. So I'm going to use it for embellishment, so why not using that for paper? So the first layer of the papers, I think it's upside down, but who cares, really? And then I'm going to add the second layer, so this is going to look really nice on the side. And then we're really going for vintage look. Now I realize I forgot to show you one more element I wanted to include, but I hope you will forgive me this mistake. Now some of the paper strips, just to make the composition a bit longer. So you can see why not really stressed with the way I stamp. If I don't like it, I can always cover that with the next strip. So, you know, if there's something ugly, there's always a way to hide it. Okay, so we've got starting point. Now, what else we can add to it to make it look nicer? I forgot that I was planning to use some of the new Prima washi tapes. Aren't they just amazing? They are so beautiful. So I will pick something going nicely with this. So you can see I used this one in the background of my bag. So I will try this one and maybe this one or the toilet. Why not? Sounds very sophisticated. And I probably, again, Pascal is laughing here because I pronounce it in a very bad way. But my French doesn't exist, so I just pretend. I'm just adding that as another layer. And they're going to create the look, which is basically following the look of the stamps in the background. Yes. So let's add some of the tapes. They're really things it is very easy to get addicted to because they go everywhere nicely. So if you like patterns, just look at these ones. Absolutely beautiful. All right. Let's find a spot where we can hopefully make sure they will be at least partly visible. These vintage adverts look just delicious. Standard salt. I feel inspired already. Standard salt. Okay, so adding more of the layers to it. That is just like the bottom layer of the bag, just to show you again that you don't need to stress out because a lot of that is going to be covered. So if something goes wrong, you know, just deep breath and pretend this is exactly what you wanted and you are super excited about the results. This is sometimes the best way. Okay, so I have the main composition done. Now, if you feel this is too empty, you can always stamp a little bit more on the top. Maybe I will stamp just a bit here. Because I can. And I like stamping. And for balance, I will stamp on the other way. So this is not the way you should be using clear stamps, just to make sure that everybody knows. You should be removing every single one like this. And you should be putting them on the block. And then you should be finding just the right spot and stamp it in there, because this is the right way of doing it. But people like me, they are not very much into following the rules. So I do things like you can see on the example. I'm not getting really stressed because of the results. So this stamp collection, this is the one that I made for Michaels. This is called Carte Postale. I have no idea how do you say it?
Carte Postale.
Carte Postale, Pascal said. So it means postcard, basically, in French, but looks much more cool and sounds much more romantic. That's why everybody loves French people, because they just have beautiful language. And this is... that's the, you know, natural thing. If you see French, it looks much more romantic and you just want to have it included in your collection. So for extra touches, I'm using the fabric tape. I didn't use it in the original design, but I'm just giving you all the possible options I can find on my table. Fabric tape is one of my favorites. I usually buy it in the pharmacy. So there's no special... supply or name for it. This is the one you just use when you cut your finger and then you have to keep it clean. So what is great about it, it's really giving beautiful texture and it gets the color really nicely. Now, time to build the dimension, I think. Okay, so this is like the bottom layer. So we have to think about placing the photo somewhere and then surrounding that with other elements we would like to use. So as you can see, photo is more or less in the middle, so we have spaces to put other elements around. So it's like one of the last elements I'm going to add, but I have to remember that it goes on my project. So let's find my photo, because I lost it already. Okay. So I have this lovely vintage girl and it's going to go somewhere, more or less here. But first I need to add some other layers under the photo. So I will try to find some maybe tags that will go with my color palette nicely. I think this one will be really good. And this. Seems to be a good solution as well. Oh, this is really nice as well. So I have these three to play with. Mm-hmm. And now they don't have the holes, so I have to make the holes myself. And I'm not the master of precision, but hopefully it's going to work. Beautiful. So now I'm going to add them under the composition. So part of that is going to be visible. I think this one will be nicer here. So I'm just sticking part on that side and the second part somewhere on the opposite side for balance. Now let's try with this one. Well, if you feel I'm completely destructive, it's okay to feel this way. I know I am. And it's okay to do it other ways if you prefer to be more precise when you are placing your elements. Just feel free to do whatever makes you feel comfortable. I think one more layer is going to be even better. So now I have that much. I am missing elements on the top and I'm missing some smaller details. If you think that you are missing smaller details, it's good to look at the different ephemera that Prima has or some stickers. Here with this collection I had elements like that, so I had some really nice little bits and pieces that you can include into your project. So something like small tags, circles and labels, or even hearts if you are into hearts. Okay, so I took elements like that and I'm going to add them here and there for extra detail. So I really think this will go here on the top, maybe on a piece of paper. Okay, so this is something that I'm adding here, and then this one will go on the top as an extra element to make it more interesting. So you can see I keep using the same heavy body gel, 3D gloss gel for gluing over and over. And you may feel this is not real glue, but believe me, it's going to hold everything in place perfectly. And you would be surprised how convenient it really is. So you can see I can lift the elements and change the position if I really want to. For some time, before the elements are really dry, I can still reposition them. So it is maybe more messy way of gluing things. And I agree, this may be not comfortable for everybody. But on the other hand, I got used to it so much that this is very natural way of gluing for me. So you can see the layers are growing. I'm just getting more and more details here. And I have empty space here as well. So I'm going to put this one. I really easily get carried away when it comes to gluing. So remember, you don't have to put so many layers. Now we need to add something fluffy. Something fluffy, maybe, for example, piece of lace or piece of the cheesecloth or even piece of twine. Right, so these are the elements I used in the original project. I have some twine for my tags and I have some of the cheesecloth. This is going to create messy texture under my photo. So cheesecloth is really well distressed and worn out because I was using this piece many times in the past. And I'm going to glue it in the middle. Maybe I just make this knot a little bit more loose. Okay, so this is one of the elements. Then I'm going to add some lace. These are beautiful Prima trims. And I'm going to cut them and add them as another layer here and there. Because there's always better to have more layers. And you're probably wondering why on earth I'm doing that to the brown paper bag? And the right answer is because it's fun. And sometimes it's really great to make the packaging for the gift the art itself. So sometimes it's just lovely process to make something very special for your friend or another artist. And they will appreciate not just because of what is inside, but also because of what is outside. You know, many people were involved into male art movement, and they are still doing that. And this is a similar concept. So maybe this is not exactly male art, but this is like gift bag art. And I think personalizing items may be one of the best sources of inspiration. People are creating tags. And tags, in the very beginning of the idea, they were just add-ons to the gifts, right? So they are labels that were added to the clothes or little things you buy in the shop. Then later they change into work of art. So why not changing paper bags into work of art? I can't see any reason why not to do it. So you can see how much of the layers I'm adding, putting more and more, trying to make it as dimensional as possible. So we have bottom layers ready. I need to add a little bit more of the texture, and I would like to add the twine, and then we are going to work on the embellishing. So the twine is just very popular baker's twine. I have the black color one, so probably it would be smarter to do it when the tag was not glued in, but some people are getting a bit too excited when they create and they forget about things like that, if you know what I mean. Then I have the lace, I have the twine, but I don't have any of the, I have the cheesecloth, I don't have any of the twine. It's just very thick thread, the one you use for sewing jeans, for example, like denim trousers, denim pieces of clothing. So it's super thick. So it's really like thinner version of twine. Can you see my sophisticated way of gluing? I hope you can just see exactly how precise I am with application, because it's very important. Right. And now the photo again, just to measure where the elements will go. Okay, perfect, right? So we've got this little girl going to sit here, and I wanted to add some elements which will be more girly and more vintage. For example, I'm going to add the paper flowers, but before I'm going to put them in, I want to add some technique to them, so they're going to look much cooler. And I hope you will like this idea, and maybe you will use it in the future. So the plan was to use like a big flower that was going to go partly under the photo, like this one. So something of this kind. Then to balance that with the, maybe something like this rose. They had a really, really nice rose somewhere here. I wanted to use maybe this one. So I'm trying to really pick the flowers which are neutral colors, so I have easier job to do. So I picked these three to be my flowers for this project. And I'm going to place them in a triangle, in a way, so they are going to give me the good support. This is a bit too big. I get something smaller. Good support for the photo. Maybe I will find something smaller here. Oh, that is a really small flower. Maybe not the most straight one, but okay. So again, something under the photo, just to create the texture. And they're going to be the background layers going together with the image, but they need extra touches, right? So I'm going to treat them first. This is going on the side. I'm making more space on my table. I'll take just one more in case if I will damage the first one, because it may happen. And now I'm going to use a bit of mat just in case, because I'm going to use the heat gun as well. So my plan was to add a bit of like a marbling and rusty effect to them. So I'm putting 3D gel on the top. And again, you can see the sophisticated application of the gel on the top, right? It is going to be so precise technique that I'm sure you can't follow without extra practice. And then again, the next one. Yes, Pascal is trying not to laugh loud, but I'm trying hard. I'm trying hard to make her laugh, so maybe it will work. So first I'm just adding something sticky, right? And 3D gloss gel would work nicely. And, you know, if you are not precise, that should work really well, because perfection in this kind of effect is overrated. And then I'm going to use the mica powder. And I'm going to put the mica powder directly on the top without any spraying, just sprinkling that directly from the container. And to make it look rusty, I'm going to use the 3 colors of mica powder. So this is going to be like the pale silver, gold, and then rusty color. And I don't think it's any official technique to use the mica powder, but why not? If you have it in the shaker like I do, you can just sprinkle it. And then it's going to dry in a really beautiful way. The only problem is it goes everywhere. That's why I'm working on the mat. Okay. Can you please? Oh, thank you. The brown one doesn't want to go out that much. Probably it's too full. Okay. Now, taking these in a safe place. Trying to tap off the excess. Now, getting rid of the excess with the baby wipe, so it will stick to the baby wipe, not to me. And then drying that with the heat gun, so the mica will stick to the gel medium. And now we have super dust effect. For a moment. Okay. So later when you look at my rose, you can see it is really rusty and really pretty. Yeah, okay, so this is the result I'm getting now with my 3D gel. So it's like a crusty but shiny texture. I just came with this concept on Sunday when I was doing the project, so I don't have the official name for the technique yet. But just in case, you know, mica powders you can get in many, many colors. You don't have to follow the vintage idea. You can make your own favorite combination. I just wanted to get something really nicely vintage. So these are ready. Okay, so now I can stick them to my composition, more or less in the place I would like to have them, on the top of my twine and my cheesecloth. So again, I have to go back to Old Faithful 3D Gloss Gel or any other heavy gel medium. For example, heavy body gel would also work, but we don't really use that heavy elements, like super, super heavy ones. So 3D Gloss is doing the job perfectly. So careful application of the gel. And now that should sit nicely. Now, right positioning. So I will show both of the flowers are visible. Okay. And then the last one for the extra balance in here. So it should work more or less like this. Just pulling this one a little bit more to the side, I think. So you can see, I don't really glue my image early. I try to just use it for measuring and the right positioning. and then later I take it away. So this is what we wanted to get, the messy flowers with the rusty finish on the top, right? And then the photo will go here. This is the plan. But before we are going to do the all gluing, we need to add some of the finishing touches. We need some rusty elements, and I have some extra ones as well. They are real metal objects. These are the ones that my husband collected for me when he was deconstructing our old chicken coop. So that was the thing that he was doing in the last weeks, and he knows that he should not throw away anything rusty, so he's always putting that in the containers. So sorry, these are my mechanicals that you can find in the your local craft stores, and this is going to be something that you can replace with similar embellishments. You know, this is just an idea. And I just need to get more of the heavy body gel, and I will show you where they're going to go. They're going to go under the photo, and here's a piece of the chicken wire. Okay, so this is going to be the plan. We are adding these under the photo first. This chicken wire, it was really rusty little thing. I have another similar element, so maybe this is going to be the great replacement. Well, technique of gluing again is not going to be very sophisticated. I am using a big blob of gel, and I'm going to place it just in the layers. And again, I take one of the nails. Oh, this is so beautiful. Ooh, I need to find out, maybe this cog will be perfect first. Wait, first I glue the cog, big blob of gel, and I put it in. I check with my photo. Lovely. And now I'm adding the nail. And if you see part of the gel, don't panic. Remember, it's going to be covered with the finishing touches. So I really love using real found objects. And I really think this is the spirit of mixed media, that you can use different mediums, different kind of supplies, including the found objects, and create art. Just making sure this is going to stick. Okay. Checking with the photo. This one needs a little bit more of the extra support. Ah, sorry, more gel. So I have composition like this. European site for Finnabair items, please. Mixedmediaplace.com. That would be probably the easiest way to buy my products. Mm-hmm. Okay, and maybe one more here, because we can put more, because I have so many lovely rusty elements. And now, in here, I'm going to add the last rusty cog. So you can see with the gel, you can quite easily work with the elements, and you can change the position, but once you will dry, it's going to get permanent. So now I'm going to give it a moment of drying before I'm going to start working on the color. Just to show you what we are going to do, right? We are going to dry and then adding some finishing touches with the color. So again, let's check. Okay, I'm just now checking with my finger if they're staying in place. You can see that the gel is still white, but it doesn't mean We cannot continue. Just this little place. Yes, Karen, she's trying to give you the idea, but really there is a lot of stores in Canada and the US which carry Prima, and they also have my products in stock. And if you can't find in your local craft store, let them know that you would like to buy it. And also you can try to find them online. You should be able to find without a problem, because it's easier. Because you are very close to the source. Okay, ready. Time to add the color, a little bit of bling and finishing touches. So if you look at my project, you can see I was basically adding only one color, and this was brown. And this brown comes from the tea infusion. And I answered the question, this is not just any tea, it has to be black tea, which means it has to be black tea of quite strong taste. It has to be something strong. If you don't have strong tea, you just put a couple of tea bags in the hot water, let it brew, let it get the color, and then you have it. I just do it from time to time, and for my convenience, I put it in a Prima bottle. So I have tea spray. And this is the source of the most beautiful brown vintage color. You can see this. All color on this project comes from the tea only. And gel, yes, gel will be completely transparent after drying, so you won't see it. This is the purpose of using gel. And these little elements you can see here, these little blobs of gel will be covered anyway. You don't see them because I will make sure you won't. And this is ready for spraying. Green tea or rooibos or herbal tea, it's not going to work. You can try with instant coffee, but then I know it gets sticky. So it's up to you. You can try. I think the tea is the best. So I'm just adding the color. And now, in some of the places on the flowers, the gel is going to be my resist. So it's going to look even more cool. I'm making sure I'm spraying the lace and making puddles of color on my project. You can see it is very simple. You don't really have to worry much, and you can dry right away. So I'm using popular everyday Irish tea, Lloyd's or Barry's. I know if you're in UK, you can easily use most of the brands, for example, Yorkshire tea. Lipton also works, but I know from United States, your Lipton is much, much more delicate, so make sure you use a lot of tea bags. Okay. So now, before gluing my photo, the last styling of my cheesecloth, making sure it's going to look absolutely fabulous. Right. Checking the photo again. That is going to work just perfect. Now, to cover the blobs of gel you may not like and to add tiny bit more of the detail to the project, you can, for example, look at your microbeads. And I have my silver microbeads here. And you can use just a tiny bit more of the 3D gloss gel or any other transparent gel medium. And I'm going to put that in all the places where I would love to see my beads. And I'm using regular brush for that. In fact, the older brush, the better. I can do that on the flowers as well, or somewhere next to the texture. Right. Sprinkling now the microbeads. You can pick any color you like. I'm quite happy with the silver. I think I need a bit more of the gel here. So it's going to be really shiny. And then, of course, we have to tap off the excess. And the last little detail I was adding to the photo before gluing it down, you can see I added even more twine and a little old paper clip. So if you still have your twine on the table, for example, for me, it was just this very basic thread, you can add really cool detail to your photo. So I'm just adding some of the extra layers. And hopefully I will be able to make a knot. Sorry. So stylish. Just perfect little add-on. And the paperclip. I have to tell you the story of my paperclips. One day an accident happened and we had leak in our roof in the studio, and water collected in some of my containers, and one of them was the paperclip container, and I discovered that after 2 days. So before I could rescue my paperclips, they really got covered with natural rust. So now I have almost endless supply of the rusty paperclips, and this is all just because the leak that we had in the roof. Right, so now how to stick it? Well, the easiest way would be simply to put something dimensional under it. For example, a piece of cardboard, or if you maybe have some 3D foam squares, it's going to be a great solution as well. I usually start with some foam squares in the empty spots, so I'm trying to level that up a little bit, because I know I have a very uneven surface. These are scrapbook adhesives, very, very strong. A very great, good quality 3D foams, and I can recommend this brand because I was using that for a long time, and they really have great quality adhesives for any kind of paper crafts, including mixed media, because you can believe it or not, these ones are not going to melt when you use the heat gun over them. So for me, for my projects, this is just the perfect solution. So I need to add a bit more. So you can see, maybe sometimes it's better to just use cardboard. And they're very sticky, as you can see. Sticking to my fingers now. Right, so removing the squares, peeling the paper off. The last one. Last one. You can see how sticky it is? Huh? Told you. Okay. Now, putting the photo in the perfect position. And now the only thing you have to do is to dry your micro beads and maybe add some nice sentiment on the top or on the bottom. For example, we could do dusty envelopes or return requested is not a good idea. Maybe delivered would be much better. Return requested would be not very great for the gift. But now you just add the very last detail. You can also stamp your sentiment on a piece of paper, and this way you have almost endless supply of very cool little sayings. And the set I was showing you, the set of stamps, has a lot of them. They're really a cool one, like postcard, own your story matters, cut and paste, just create. All of these are possible to be used for the lovely sentiments. And I'm adding smaller foam squares now, so it is going to be a bit more dimensional. And this is basically the last step of the project. So I know that we've got a lot of different stickers, and Prima has great selection of the stickers of different kinds. You can use stamps, you can use your typewriter if you have. There are many options of getting good sentiment for your finishing touch delivered. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is the end result. So just to compare to the original one, which is completely dry, you can't see any of the gel here, right? So this is going to be invisible in just a couple of minutes. I just have to dry it again. And very quickly, you can create your own composition. What I really believe in is when you're making vintage projects, something which is really working with old photos or old paper, you should be using as many original old elements as possible. That's why I really think adding old nails or pieces of wire or pieces of the old lace is the whole beauty, because you've got the ability to really give them the second life. And this is what I love about projects like this. You can just incorporate them into your project and they're giving you so much of the lovely detail. I hope you enjoyed, and I hope that you are going to try some of the techniques I was showing today. And I know that multi-layering for some of you may be a bit overwhelming, but you just have to try and see how it works. This is something that may be much more fun to do than you think, because once you start adding the elements and gluing them down, they really start to have their own life and they have more and more of the details. If you think that you don't have enough elements, really try to look in your garage, in your kitchen, maybe somewhere in the basement or attic, and you may find the most amazing supply of the elements you can use for your project. So let me just say my goodbyes in a moment. Thank you so much for joining us. And that was Finnabair with Prima Marketing, and I was showing you how to make this vintage gift bag. So it's basically altered project, but you can easily apply these techniques to your journal pages, canvases, or your scrapbook pages as well. So thank you so much, guys, for joining. And I hope that you are going to tell your friends about this video and you are going to share it with them. And please don't forget to visit the websites. First of all, finnabair.com, which is the blog. And then we've got very inspiring tutorials twice a week and a lot of videos waiting for you in the video section. On the top of the blog, there are the tabs and you can just check all the information about the product. Second good one is, of course, finnabair@michaels.com, because once we were doing the release for Michaels, we made a great compilation of the basic mixed media techniques for all the people who would like to begin. And Prima blog, which is the one of the most beautiful blogs out there with the beautifully flowery inspiration, it's the next place you should visit. If you are willing to be more up to date with what we are doing here and you would like to follow the designs, the project from me and my design team, please follow us on Instagram and subscribe to the Facebook page, because this is exactly how we communicate with you. So thank you so much, Karen, for the help, and thank you so much for joining us. And I hope to see you in my social media. If you make the project inspired by this video, please message me, tag me on the photo, because I would like to see it. You can do it on Facebook or on Instagram. I try to check both places. And thank you again. It was lovely to have you here. And I hope to see you in about 2-3 weeks again for the next Facebook Live. And in the meantime, please don't forget, we have a lot of Facebook events going on done by Prima designers, and you can learn a lot about the products, about the techniques. So I hope it was really a good evening for you. All right.